This is Tom Scott's Podcast Express. Conversations about music, movies, politics, art, and a whole lot more with some of Tom's very special friends. Without further ado, here's Tom.
Hi, I'm Tom Scott. My guest today is an entertainment icon who is, or has been at one time or another, a talent manager, songwriter, record producer, music executive, film producer, film director, and successful club owner. He was a prime force in the success of several music celebrities, Jan and Dean, the Mamas and Papas, the Grassroots, Barry McGuire, Johnny Rivers, Cheech and Chong, and Carole King, among others. Carole's album Tapestry, which he produced, has been certified diamond, selling more than 10 million units. In 1967, he helped conceive and produce the Monterey Pop Festival, 2 years before Woodstock took place, and paved the way for countless other rock festivals that were to follow. He produced several movies, including The Rocky Horror Picture Show, one of the longest-running films in theatrical history. He directed one of his recording acts, Cheech and Chong, in the feature film Up in Smoke, which was also a major hit. Then he decided to open a nightclub, the Roxy, on the Sunset Strip in 1973. It's still open nearly 50 years later. The Hollywood Chamber of Commerce honored him with a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, and he was also inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I'd like to add, he also saw fit to help a young saxophone player boost his solo career. That young saxophone player was me. It's a pleasure to introduce my guest, Lou Adler. Welcome.
Thank you very much. I'm out of here. I mean, that's...
that sums it up.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, thanks, Tom. It's a pleasure to be here with you, Tom.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Well, I'd like to talk a little bit about your early days and so on. You grew up in Boyle Heights, an area of downtown Los Angeles. Could you give us a sense of what it was like growing up there?
Well, the way that I explained the area at that time, the basketball team that I played on at Roosevelt High School was a black kid, African-American kid, Mexican kid, a Russian kid, a Japanese kid, and this Jewish kid. That was the starting five, and that was the neighborhood. That's what the neighborhood was.
Wow. Wow. It was real mixed. Wow. What music were you exposed to in those early days?
R&B. I was very much into Huggy Boy and that radio station. Mostly R&B, some pop. Pretty much those were the two genres, never too much country.
I remember stations like KFWB.
One of the great, I mean, that was an education for me because I stayed pretty close to radio after I was into the music business because B. Mitchell Reed, who was
right,
big-time L.A. DJ and New
big
York
time,
was right, one of our partners during, yeah.
Oh, is that right? Oh, wow.
Yeah, the company was called, I'm jumping ahead, but the
that's
company
okay
was called Herb B. Lou, and it was Herbie Albert, B. Mitchell Reed, and Lou. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's awesome. Yeah. Wow, 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 wow. So at what point did you decide, I want to have a career in music?
Well, I wrote school songs. I wrote lyrics for most of the school songs during that time by taking songs like Tree in the Meadow and changing the lyric to be one of the school songs, Kelly Green and White. I always wanted to be a journalist. I thought that's what I wanted to be. But out of that came a... talent for writing lyrics, actually. And I wrote a couple of songs during that time that didn't do anything except got me to make a couple of demos. But I really entered the music business, writing and producing what became of a career when I met Herbie Albert. That was the beginning of it, yeah.
And what were the circumstances under which you guys met?
I was dating his girlfriend, actually. That became, he was in the army at the time. She became his wife later on. I wasn't dating her while she was his wife.
Right.
And her girlfriend, she introduced me to her girlfriend. And when her got out of the army, I told him that I was writing lyrics and thinking about it, being in the music business. And Herbie was a trumpet player then. He was right. A trumpet player in the army, and he was a trumpet player with a little bar mitzvah type band.
Sure.
And we started writing songs.
Right, right. As you say, you began writing songs, demos with Herb Alpert. And you, at one point, you went to Sonny Bono, who at the time was the head of A&R at Specialty Records.
Specialty Records, and, right.
Right.
Herbie and I brought him some of our demos. He said that he thought that Herb and I should look for a career in another area.
That's subtle.
And he wasn't kind at all, you know.
Really? He was mean about it.
Yeah. I talked about him. Both Herbie and I talked about him later on after we proved him wrong.
Yes.
But Sonny was a good guy. But that's what he thought.
I was going to say, I suppose he was just giving you his, at the time, his honest opinion, right or wrong. I mean, that's.
He might have been right at the time, you know, maybe not right in predicting our future, but maybe right.
No.
In the first songs that Herbie and I wrote, one was Circle Rock, which was recorded by Cowboy Copas and the Salmas Brothers. Not a big hit. They were just okay, you know.
Yeah, right.
One of them was All of My Life, which ended up being a Sam Cooke song, actually.
Nice. Well, I was going to say, you ended up signing a contract with King Records and producing their top artist, Sam Cooke.
What happened was Bumps Blackwell, who was an underrated, unnoticed, entrepreneurial African-American before Motown, before any of those, you know, Berry Gordy, et cetera. Bumps was trying. He didn't have the wherewithal, but he was trying. And he hired Herbie and I as A&R assistants. I don't know if we split $42 a week or if we each got $42 a week. And that was our introduction to Sam Cooke.
Right, you know. Right. The tune Wonderful World, which people, I know that people confuse it with What a Wonderful World, but Wonderful World is the one that starts out, don't know much about history.
Yeah, exactly.
And
I'd say the other one, too. If they say the other one, I say fine. Yeah.
Okay. You're not picky. Okay. But anyway, that tune, the other tune, which was written by the two of you, was made into a Sam Cooke demo, and then it was shelved by King Records, right?
Wonderful World. Keen Records had started to build a studio on 3rd Street, and the glass pack was still in the walls, and Sam wanted to try it out for sound. So we went in, and we had the regular musicians that were on Sam Cooke Records, except for a drummer. And Renee Hall, who was a guitar player on most of Sam's records, said, I think it was him, said, my nephew plays drums. Let me see if I can get a hold of him. 16 years old. He came in. He played drums on Wonderful World, actually.
Wow.
So we were testing the studio. And, right, it was not shelled because it was good or bad. It was shelved because it wasn't made as a record.
Oh, as a studio test.
And then years, not too long after that, a couple of years, I guess, Sam signed with RCA Victor. And Herbie and I had left Keen And they went back and looked to see what they had on Sam so that they could put it all. And it's sort of fortunate for Sam because the first two records that he recorded for RCA didn't sound much like Sam Cooke. Not the Sam Cooke that was You Send Me, When You Love, and eventually, yeah. So they put it out, and it was, you know, a top 10 record, top 5 record.
Wow.
Don't know much about history. Don't know much biology. Don't know much about a science book. Don't know much about the French I took, but I do know that I love you, and I know that if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be. Don't know much about geography.
So I talked to Herb, and he said that you guys eventually split up, and the way you did it was that you took Jan and Dean, and he took the tape recorder.
Yeah, he took the tape recorder. Right. He might have put Lonely Ball on it. So,
so Jan and Dean was an act that you had that you found.
Yeah, Herbie and I had a hit with Jan and Dean, "Baby Talk," which was our first actually hit record, and I was close with both Jan and Dean. Personally close. Herbie at that time wanted to be an act more than he wanted to be a manager. So
right.
That was an easy split. It wasn't contentious or right. anything right. like that. It was you go your way, I'll go my way. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Totally amicable.
That's so great. He took the TAC and I took Janet Dean.
Now, did you expand your artist roster at that point, or?
Yes, I did. I had a hit. Herbie and I were still together when we had Alley-Oop, actually.
Alley-Oop? Really?
We covered Alley-Oop by the Hollywood Argyles. We covered that record with Dante and the Evergreens. And that was the big record on the East Coast. And Argyles were the big coast, big record on the West Coast. Far as expanding at that time, no, I was pretty much with Jan and Dean at that time. I did some more records with Dante and the Evergreens.
But at some point, you went on and got involved with Dunhill Records, right? Is that what happened?
Yeah, no, before that, what happened is that I was looking for a follow-up for Alley-Oop, and I was in New York, and I met with Donnie Kirshner of Nevins and Kirshner Alden Music, and he said, if you're ever looking for a job, basically, give me a call. So I ended up in the publishing business for a while, working for Alden Music. I opened a West Coast brand prior to my own record companies.
I see. And how long did that go?
That lasted maybe 2 years. Let's see. I went to work for him in 1961. I left in 1964 when I recorded Johnny Rivers. That's Dunhill. That was the beginning of Dunhill. So it was 3 years. And in those 3 years, Alden Music had 34 top 10 records. And I was working with Carole and King and Jerry Goffin, Barry Mann, Cynthia Wilde, Neil Sedaka, Howie. Yeah, that was my publishing education. Yeah.
Oh my God, what an education to be around those hit makers. Fantastic.
And working with Carole.
See, you know, I was on your label, you know, in the 70s and all that, but this backstory fascinates me because, you know, by the time I met you, you're just this, like, you know, music titan. I don't know.
Yeah. We met in the 1970, I guess it was, right?
You're right. Yeah. But anyway, so you formed Dunhill, and you formed it, right? Was it a, it was
part Donald of a, started a out as a production company that distributed through Liberty Records, and I produced the Johnny Rivers records. They were released on Liberty Imperial, which Liberty had bought at the time. Then Dunhill became a label at that point. Right. Johnny was never on Dunhill Records. He was on Imperial Records through Dunhill Productions. So.
I see. And what? Tell me about Barry McGuire. How did that relationship happen?
Barry McGuire. Oh, I was at Ciro's on the Sunset Strip. And Ciro's at that time had just started booking rock and roll acts. And that would be 1965. And Barry was on the dance floor. He was barefooted. He had purple feet. And at the end of the evening, he danced his way with a conga line out onto Sunset Boulevard. And I said, Matt, this guy's got a following. I knew of him as the Christy Mitchells, because he had a couple of hits with the Christy Mitchells.
Was part of that group.
Yeah, he wrote Greenback Dollar, a couple of big hits.
Okay, right.
So I thought, this guy should be an artist. And I was working with two people, P.F. Sloan, Phil Sloan, and C. Berry. And I gave them Terry Melcher, these names, who was a very close friend and an A&R man at Columbia, had given me one of Dylan's early Electric records. And I gave it to Sloan and Berry, and I said, this is happening, write something in this vein. And they wrote Eva Destruction and matched up with Barry, and we went into the studio and recorded it.
The Eastern world, it is exploding, violence flaring, bullets loading. You're old enough to kill, but not for voting. You don't believe in war, but what's that gun you're toting? And even the Jordan River has bodies floating. But you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, you don't believe we're on the eve of destruction.
Wow. And it was it intended to be a statement about the Vietnam War, or was it just the timing was such?
Well, it certainly was a timing, and on as far as P.F. Sloan or Phil Sloan, was Phil Sloan at that time, and then he became P.F. Sloan for that genre. He changed his name, et cetera. I pretty much made records for the music and lyrics and the production. I was more the messenger as far as protesting and those things. I wasn't necessarily protesting. It was still a record to me that I was producing.
Right.
But the timing was right. It was it was pretty much the first rock and roll protest song. Dylan had made those songs, but they were all folk songs.
Folk songs. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
So a couple of years later, of course, we had the teen revolution. And so did you consider yourself part of the counterculture movement? Or, as you say, were you just the messenger?
Yeah, I never thought of myself in that way. Thinking in retrospect, I just was who I was. And a lot of the things that I was happening for the first time. So you don't look at yourself and say, now I'm starting. You're just there, you know. It's a case of timing. You know?
Timing, it is.
Being in the right place at the right time, or being right for the time. So,
Right, right. Now, in 67, you decided to, you planned the Monterey Pop Festival, right?
Yes. I had already produced the Mamas and Papas records.
Oh, you had. And that was Dunhill also.
That was 1965, 66.
Right. You told me a story years ago about John Phillips and the tunes that he wrote for that first album, that he took a trip.
Yeah, he took 85 trips.
Well, on this particular occasion,
they were coming off of 80 trips, I guess. When I met them, I was probably, they had been at the Caribbean, and they were just returning from this major trip. So.
I see. How did you meet them?
Barry McGuire, actually. Cass knew Barry. They were all, except for, even Michelle, who had been in the Journeyman folk group, even though she was a rock and roll baby, when John met her, I guess, when he turned her into a singer so that she would be close to him. John had that knack of doing things like that. But Cass, they were in San Francisco at the time, and Cass called Barry and said that they were coming to L.A. and looking for a deal, that they had started a group. And he said, hey, you ought to come and see my producer. And that's how I met them. Yeah. They came.
Wow.
They came down to Western Recorders. We were recording in Studio C. I was recording Barry's album in Studio C. I auditioned them in one of the other studios, Studio A, I think. And they were the funkiest looking people I had ever seen outside of Fifth Street in L.A. And I had a habit of, because there were no videos, I would try to imagine what the group would look like to somebody that was hearing them on the radio. So
right.
I would close my eyes during the audition. So
right.
I closed my eyes during the audition, having seen Michelle, who was the most beautiful girl that I had ever seen, maybe. John, who was the tallest rock and roller. Denny looked sort of like Earl Flynn or someone like that, a movie star. And Cass was the biggest woman that I had ever seen singing. So I closed my eyes and they sang me California Dreamin', Go Where You Wanna Go, and just... I opened my eyes, and it became the title of the first album, If You Could Believe Your Eyes and Ears.
I remember that. Yeah. So they had this worked out when they came to audition for you. They had those tunes.
They had five songs, right. Cass had not committed to being in the group yet, but had committed to rehearsing with them.
I see.
But when she saw the contract, she committed. That was or the advance, which wasn't very much,
No, but hey, when you're looking like they did, it probably was quite attractive, whatever it was.
Right.
Oh my Lord, that's very funny. Isn't it funny how things happen? As you say, timing. Okay, so you had already signed them, and they had this huge hit. So
Monterey Pop, it was a guy named Ben Shapiro, who was an agent at William Morris.
I know Ben Shapiro. I knew him, actually.
Yeah. He also had a great club where the Renaissance Club, where Miles played, actually, you know, right off of on Sunset Boulevard.
Right.
But it was him and, I'm trying to recall, they came to us to a hire. They had an idea for a one-day festival in Monterey, at the Monterey Festival, where the jazz festival was.
Fairgrounds, the fairgrounds.
Jazz, that's right, Monterey Fairground. And they wanted to hire the Mamas and Papas to headline that night. They had signed Ravi Shankar, and they had some blues acts that they were going to sign. And they offered more money than the Mamas and Papas had ever received for a night. We said we'd think about it. And it was about 2 or 3 in the morning that the phone rings, and it's Sean Phillips. Not unusual for him to call me at 2 or 3, or for him to be up at 2 or 3 in the morning. And he said, you know, I've got an idea. He said, we ought to do this. We ought to do this festival, and we should do it for charity, and we should give the money back because we're all doing so great that this is a way to give the money back. And I'm thinking, you know, John's whatever he's drinking, smoking, and sniffing at that particular time, this is his idea. Then I start thinking about it and talk to John the next day, and we started to get into it and turned it into what Monterey eventually was, Monterey Pop.
So you decided to, I mean, he was into getting more acts, expanding the...
Doing it more than one day. Yeah, that came...
Right.
When we started talking about it, I said, John, we're not going to do all of this for one day.
And right.
It eventually became 3 days, you know, as
right.
more people got involved. Started talking about it.
So did it turn out to be a charity event for everybody, or did people get paid?
To this day, we give away more money than we ever gave away. And that's because of all of the assets that came out of it. The Pennybaker film, all of the audio that was recorded, all of those albums. The only one that was paid was Ravi Shankar, because he was on the first contract before we got involved.
Wow. So where did this money go?
It went to, that's what Rolling Stone kept saying, you know.
Did they?
Where's the money? You know, the money is, the first money went to the LA Free Clinic and the San Francisco Free Clinic.
So various charities and charitable causes.
The idea informed the mission was to give it to street people as far as education and health. The two free clinics were perfect. That worked out perfect. But it just went on from there. And Otis Redding Scholarship we have. We had a guitar center in educational center in Harlem.
Wow.
All those kinds of things. And
awesome.
Like I said, today we're still giving away the money. The money still comes in. There's no overhead. Jeez. We don't take any overhead for it. It just worked out.
That is awesome. It really is. Oh, yeah. My gosh. So you went on to form Ode Records.
Yeah, after Dunhill was Ode Records, yeah. It was a deal with A&M. I went back with Herbie. they were the distributor, and I had an office on the lot right next to the studio, which I returned to recently. I'll tell you about that after a while. I did an album with Mary Clayton, a gospel album.
Oh, my Lord.
Yeah. You know, so I went back to A&M, and we started Ode Records. And I mean, it was a beautiful relationship with Herbie and Jerry Moss. Gil Friesen, you know, you could walk across the lot and talk to them, and it was just perfect.
The atmosphere at that place was so cool. It was just, it felt like a a nice pillow around you. You know, yeah. I mean, it was just, yeah. It was glorious. Amazing. And, you know, the atmosphere everywhere. And then you'd walk into the recording studios and there would be, I don't know, Billy Preston, Joni Mitchell, Carol, Herb, yeah. The Carpenters. You just never knew. It was so much creative stuff going on there.
Yeah.
It was amazing.
And fortunately, I met Hank Sakala there, who was such an important part of the, certainly, Tapestry. There's so much of Hank Sakala in Tapestry.
Well, since you brought him up, I'm delighted you did. Tell us more about Hank and your relationship with him.
Yeah, well, Hank was perfect for me because my musical ability is instinct. There's no education. I don't play an instrument. I was a lyric writer. For some reason, I had really good feel for drums and vocals. And Hank was able to technically fill in anywhere that I had a vacuum. Plus, he's not only a musical guy, but he's a lyrical guy. He understands artists. And the match was just so, and he can mic a piano like nobody ever mic'd a piano. And for Carole King, that was key, you know. It was such a beautiful relationship. I stay in touch with Hank, but that was key. And also his personality. So easy to get along with, you know.
Yeah, well, as you know, we were joined at the hip there for a three or four years. He became my recording engineer and recording mixer, and I wouldn't have had anybody else. He was a delight.
Well, I mean, the LA Express albums are albums that people talk to me about all the time, and anytime that I sit down with anybody to talk about my career or the past, and they talk about the LA Express albums. You
know? That's awesome. Yeah. Wow. Well, it wouldn't have happened without Hank. Hank, of course, is the guy who came into the club we were playing, the Baked Potato, and said, hey, you guys want to come in on some downtime? It's weekends. Because I think we did that whole first album on weekends. I think.
Well, it cost me $100,000 in time. No, I'm just kidding.
That happened.
That's the other thing about Hank. He was so organized in a studio. And so he wasn't a guy that, you know, there was a lot of money wasted in those days. Hank didn't believe in that. The studio was there. That was a job. We're here to do a job. You know?
Right. But that, to me, and listen, let me say this now. I was always grateful to you because that is true. But and we, it was expensive to make the kinds of records we were making. I mean, it was lots of hours of, you know, recording, mixing, musicians, all the stuff that it took to make the records that I made, I know, and others. And you never once said, "Oh, you got to tighten up the budget." I mean, you gave us a free hand, and I always appreciated that very much.
Yeah, that's what I felt. You know, I respected the musicians that I was working with and the talent that was happening in that studio, that I never felt like you have to put any kind of stop on it. Once you start, let them go. They're going to show you where it should go. And that's the way I felt. And part of that was my own shortcomings as a musician that I respected and also believed in who I was working with, you know. And there were some good guys in there, you know.
Sure were. What a great group, huh? Gosh, I think of all the people. Well, while we're on this subject, we came up with this LA Express band, which it was Tom Scott and the LA Express for the first record. And then we went on tour with Joni Mitchell. It was going to be a 6-week tour of little colleges in January of 74. Her record, Court and Spark, went on the charts and wouldn't leave. And the tour kept getting extended. Elliot Roberts, her manager, kept, you know, negotiating more and more dates. Culminating, I remember, in, I believe, October in London, England, Wembley Stadium. 100,000 people with the, you know, the band, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, wow. and Joni Mitchell and Tom Scott of the LA Express. Like, how did I get in there? But anyway, it was awesome. But what I wanted to talk to you about, while we were on the road, the two most, shall we say, business-oriented guys in the band, Max Bennett and John Guerin, the bass player and drummer.
I heard from them forever, every time I sent the check. And then I heard from the estates, you're not kidding about business.
I had no idea. That's so funny. But listen, but they came to me on the tour and said, listen, Tom, we think this band is really the thing. And when we really like it to just be the LA Express without Tom Scott's name in front of it. And I was like, okay, you know, I didn't really think about it. Fine. You know, I just want to be in a good band. Fine. So I waltzed into your office one day and I said, Lou, I've been talking to the guys in the band and we have decided, they asked me and I said it was okay. We've decided that we're going to take my name off it and just call this, and it was the Tomcat album, the one coming up, going to just call it the LA Express. And you looked me straight in the eye and said, Tom, I don't think so. And I was so taken aback. And then you said, Tom, I don't think you should immerse yourself in a band. I think you have other things that you could be doing. And I think I don't think it's a good move for you. I mean, you were acting as my manager, which I really appreciated very much. Because I was as shocked as I was to hear that. In retrospect, I'm certainly grateful. But it certainly did cause a rift. So I had to go back to the guys and tell them, guys, it's not going to happen. And I think to the day he died, John Guerin was convinced that you and I conspired to, you know, screw them out of there.
I'm sure he did.
But that's the way it happened. And, of course, the next thing that happened, you said, so they left and went with Jim Gersio, Caribou Records, the LA Express, without me. And you said to me, I went in your office one day, and he said, so, Tom, what do you want to do next album? And I said, well, I'd love to make a record with those New York guys. And that led to, of course, the New York Connection, which was one of the highlights of my life, being in that studio with that group. Man, oh, that was good.
The Connection album is really good.
Oh, man, that's my favorite. It really is. Good Lord.
And why do they sample you so much?
Well, you tell me. I never hear about it.
It's mostly Max, actually. They sample Max.
Mostly
Max.
Oh, Max. Well, John, that drum thing of John's, that's...
Those two guys. Yeah.
So maybe they were right. Maybe I should have stuck out with the LA Express.
Right. It might have been right. It's a funny story.
Oh, my Lord. So I want to talk about Carole because... now I know, I didn't know this before. You met several years earlier when you were in publishing. That's when you met Carole, and now you brought her in as an artist. How did that idea come about?
So that would have been 64 when I left and didn't have much contact with any of them. Every once in a while with Carole and Jerry because I became friends, and Barry Mann, I became friendly with them. And what I realized, that, which eventually became, I'm jumping ahead a little, what became the sound on Tapestry was that the demos that Carole was doing when she was primarily a writer at Alden Music is when I would give them one person who you would know, Snuff Garrett, I'd give him a demo. I couldn't get it back. He loved the demos. He wasn't the only A&R man or artist that didn't want to keep Carole's demos. So I guess it was, there were a couple of albums before Tapestry. There was, she did an album called The City with Charlie Larkey on bass and Danny Korchmer and Jim Gordon. On drums, actually. Yeah, so I produced an album with the group The City. Carole sort of buried herself in the group. She didn't want to be an artist. And Danny Cooch sang some of the songs and did a couple of leads on it. And it was a really good album that made a lot of top 10 best album lists. But at the time I was leaving CBS, where I had a distribution deal, and it just got lost. The album got lost. Then Jerry Goffin produced an album with her and didn't do much. And then I did an album called Nothing. There was a space in there. I started getting interested in doing film, and I produced a film for Robert Altman called Brewster McCloud, and spent most of my time in Texas. So I wasn't able to produce any records, or I stopped producing records at that point, and I was just working on film.
Shelley Duvall was in that,
Shelley,
right?
We found Shelley in Texas. She wasn't an actress. She came to us to sell her boyfriend's paintings or something. And Altman was crazy. He said, she's the lead in the movie, you know.
So, just declared it.
Yeah, that's right. He was wild. We would finish shooting, and then we'd come back to the apartments where we were staying, and he would ask everyone to smoke a joint, and then he would mix Bloody Marys. He'd stand up and say, nobody in this room knows what this movie is about except me. And he would go into his room and rewrite the next day's pages. So he was right. And when the movie was made, the audience felt the same way. Nobody knew what the movie was about except him. Anyway, so when that finished, when I finished with Brewster McCloud, I came back, and when Carol moved out here from New York, she had split up with Jerry. Her marriage had split up and was no longer writing with him.
Right.
And she contacted me, and she said she wanted to do something, and that's how the City album came about. And by the time that we got around to thinking about doing an album, solo album, she had met somebody named, not somebody, but a girl named Toni Stern, who wrote the lyrics for It's Too Late, actually.
Oh.
And also gave Carol an independent, womanish feeling. She started being more of herself. She was Jerry's wife for so long, you know.
Right. Right.
And she started writing, and she met two people. She met Toni Stern, and she met James Taylor, or started hanging out with James Taylor, and started writing, and she said, I've got some songs, and started coming up to the office that A&M owed, and playing me songs that were just what turned out to be the Tapestry album, you know. And almost every song was a knockout.
Yeah. I know. It's like that rarely happens, where every song is good.
Every song.
Fantastic. I must say that I have worked with Carol. There was a tribute to her, Grammy tribute, years ago, where we did Jazz Man. And she is one of these people to this day who is a walking light. She just lights up everywhere. Everywhere she goes, she is the most marvelous human being, as just a great, yeah, great lady. Something. So I would like to move on to a little act you picked up called Cheech and Chong. How did you come to meet them, and what made you decide to do a comedy record, something a little bit out of your, you know, usual line?
Yeah, I did one comedy record before that, which I did as a favor for the people at VJ Records, where I was doing something, I forget what it was. They asked me to produce this comedy record with this British comedian. And I had fooled around with comedy in my personal life of a few times, you know, routines with different people. And so I did the funniest thing on there, of course, was no, that's not the putts that I mean, or something like that. It was a bad comedy record that fortunately nobody heard. And and I'm sorry that I mentioned it, but I was in the Troubadour one night on a Monday night. It was Hootenanny night at the Troubadour, and a girl in the bar said, "I think you ought to look out. There's an act on stage called Cheech and Chong, and you ought to take a look." Why she said it to me, I don't know. You know, it's not like I had, maybe she had heard the Putts record. I don't know. But anyway, I looked in, and Tommy and Cheech did a routine where they were dogs, and they were on stage, and they were going around in circles smelling each other's butt. Right. And that was the beginning of Ralph and Herbie, these dogs that they did. And I turned to my lawyer at the time, and after they did a couple, and I said, "I'd like to record these guys." He looked at me like I was crazy. Yeah, Tommy and Cheech was, Cheech to me, I grew up, as we talked about, I grew up in East LA. So the character that Cheech does, I went to school with, you know, so I knew the lowrider. And they were just, and also I was a big fan of Laurel and Hardy and Abbott and Costello and those comedy teams. It came pretty easy for me to work with Tommy and Cheech. It was easy.
You saw the Rocky Horror Picture Show in London as a play and decided, yes, to produce it as a feature film. Could you tell us about that?
I saw all of my things have something to do with a woman each time. In this case, it was Brett Eklund, who I had a son with, Nikolai.
Yes.
And
yes,
they were living in London, and I was living in LA. And she called and she said, "I've seen a play that I think you should come in and take a look for. It's something that you could do something with." So I flew into, I went to London. I was in jet lag, I recall. She took me to the show. It got to me right away. Tim Curry, no doubt about that. The songs being sort of 50-ish. And that night, after the play, I went to a party in London, and the original producer, Michael White, was at the party. And he told me that Stigwood was trying to make a deal with him. And right. I said, "Well, I'll put it in the Roxy in LA on Sunset Strip." And he said, "Okay." We shook hands and we made a deal. And so that was the deal for the play. And it played at the Roxy as a play for 10 months, actually, before we went off to make the film.
Okay. Oh wow, I remember. I remember they did have a long run at the Roxy,
yeah,
and it's had a long run as a movie. Boy, amazing!
It's still running. 45th anniversary this year because of the pandemic. We played 200 drive-ins across the country, and pop-ups. on the side of mausoleums, anywhere that they could show this movie. They
were showing project it.
On Halloween. Yeah. Yeah.
Unbelievable. That's amazing.
Longest running film in distribution, or the film that has run the longest in distribution.
That's an astounding record. I mean, not exactly something you had counted on, but how wonderful that it was.
No, not really. No. Not that the studio counted on. They thought it was dead.
I'm sure. What is this piece of crap you've given us here?
Yeah, exactly. Luckily, they didn't pay for it. That's what they
Oh, good. And I just want to mention one more thing. For those of you to whom Lou Adler remains a kind of a mystique mystery guy, if you've ever watched a basketball game with the LA Lakers, you see Jack Nicholson in the court side. There will be a gentleman next to him with a beard, and that would be Lou Adler. Jack and Lou have been friends for decades now, and it's been a wonderful friendship between you guys.
Oh, yeah, 1970. We're introduced by Michelle Phillips, introduced us. There's that woman again.
That's right.
Yeah, and now I'm the guy with the hat and the beard that sits next to Jack Nicholson. In fact, one last story. I was at an event for Herb and Jerry Moss were being presented with something. And I was on the dais, and Joe Smith was the host. And he was introducing everybody, and he could be brutal. And he got down to me, and he said, "Lou, I've been waiting to interview you and waiting to introduce you after all of these years, after all the hit records, after all the gold records, and after all the movies and the song. How does it feel to be known as the guy with the hat and the beard that sits next to Jack Nicholson at the Laker games?"
Your legacy. But
it's been a great friendship. A lot of people think it's Donald Sutherland, but it's me.
Lou, I cannot thank you enough for your time, and it's been a joy. You've been a great influence in my life without even knowing it. I have thought about things you've said to me.
You've been a part of mine, and this is. I hope it's good for you. It's been good for me. It's been sort of, to think about these memories, and it's been great.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
I'm getting it. I am having the time of my life. I'll be honest. It's great fun. And thanks, buddy, for a great, great interview. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Tom.
Tom Scott's Podcast Express is produced by Dave Schroeder and Joseph Vella. If you like the Podcast Express, tell your friends, write a review, and subscribe to the series on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and other fine podcast directories. Tom Scott's Podcast Express uses Blue microphones and Zoom Corporation audio recorders. Tom Scott plays R.S. Berkeley musical instruments and Jody Jazz mouthpieces. For more information or to ask Tom a question, visit tomscottmusic.com. Until next time.